Well, hello, Love Radio Network family. This is Pastor Dawn this week. I am so excited to have you with us again. Today is going to be our final episode series on overcoming or annihilating the spirit of fear in your life. And so what we do here every week is you learn some amazing techniques of how to be a mindset master. What does that mean? Well, the Bible says that as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. And so what we discuss here every single week is how you can learn to become a master of your thoughts. And if you can master your thoughts, then you can master your destiny. So again, I'm so excited to have you guys with us. We're going to jump right in. You know, I always allow the Holy Spirit to lead and guide how we're going to approach each week's content. And I was a bit shocked when he told me that we were going to go to your supernatural identity today. So let me first just lay a little bit of groundwork there. So first and foremost, you and I and everyone on the face of the planet that is a human being, we are triune beings, just like God is a triune being. So God is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And I'm assuming if you follow my podcast, then you already, I'm assuming, have accepted Jesus into your heart as your Lord and Savior. You're being led by the Holy Spirit, and you walk in submission to and in an intimate daily relationship and fellowship with God the Father. I realize that's a lot of assumptions, but at least I'm hoping that that's a starting point from where we are today as we jump off in our last episode on annihilating the spirit of fear. So what I want you to gain today is this is really a mastery level of thought in the fact that you are gaining the master's edge. In other words, you're learning how to think like God thinks, you're learning how to speak like God speaks, and you're learning how to act like God acts. Now, am I suggesting that you are God? Absolutely not. But I am suggesting that you are made in his image, created in his likeness, that you are his beloved, cherished son or daughter who was created for such a time as this, that God placed you in this dispensation of time in history so that you might be able to walk out his plans, his purposes, his callings on your life. And so what I want to go is back to our original scripture that we looked at the beginning of this particular episode series was 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7, which says, "For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but instead he has given us a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind." Now, I think it's interesting that God starts with power and then love and then soundness of mind. And if you need a little bit of a refresher of what this entire scripture entails, I do want to encourage you to go back to episodes 1 and 2 and listen to them again. But just in short recap, the spirit of fear is really anything that would cause you to shrink back, cause you to cringe, to make yourself smaller than you are, to not have a voice. Also, this is what causes, you know, people to sometimes be tormented or beset with anxieties and fears that over a period of time can turn into anxiety disorders, can turn into phobias, or at the very least, cause us to be too timid and too shy to walk out the plan and the purposes of God in our life. But God created man and women in his image. So I want to go there really quickly and just give you a really quick review of Genesis chapter 1, verses 26, 27, and 28. And so in verse 27, it says, "So God made man and woman in his own image, and in the image of God, he created them male and female." Now, why did he do that? I believe that that God created man and woman and placed them in this beautiful garden in the earth because, number one, he desired to have children. God prizes family. In fact, I believe that since love is the primary character of who God is, he desired to have children that would be a reflection of all that he is. And I believe that planet Earth was supposed to be a kingdom or a colony of heaven, that it would mirror heaven, and that he would place his children children on the earth. He would give them dominion in the earth, and that they, his sons and daughters, would then be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over everything that he created. And so I believe that according to Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 28. And so, but we've been talking about how fears can really cause us to either live in a space where we are not really able to acquire not just the things that God has called us to acquire, but really to be able to walk out our kingdom purposes. Because what happens is the enemy roams around the earth like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And so I believe that not all of us are devourable unless we allow ourselves to be devoured. So again, 2 Timothy 1:7 says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but he has given us a spirit of power. So a few weeks ago, we looked at that, and that word power is the Greek word dunamis, and that is the word which we get our English word dynamite. And the basic definition of the word dunamis is the power to perform miracles, signs, and wonders. It is the power of God, the breath of God, that lives and breathes and dwells in us day to day if we stay in intimate communication and fellowship with our Creator. And so we talked about how that power of God, that's the same power that rose Jesus Christ from the dead. The Bible says that if the same spirit that rose Christ from the dead lives and dwells in you, then it will quicken your mortal body. And that same spirit will lead and guide you into all wisdom and to all things. Okay, so why are we talking about the spirit of fear, and how does that affect how we live our kingdom responsibilities here in the earth? So what I want to do is today, I want to give you just a snapshot of your supernatural identity. And sometimes when I teach this, I have to tread lightly or be careful to make sure to point out that the enemy has created a whole nother counterfeit identity in the earth, in the area of mindset mastery, and in the area of our supernatural identity. So let me go back to Genesis. God created man and woman in his image. Why did he do that? Because he loved us. He wanted children. He wanted family. He wanted fellowship. He wanted intimacy. Just like if you are a mother or a father, you had children because you desired a family. Why do you desire to have children? Because you want this family unit where you guys live and do life together in loving fellowship and communion. There's really no other, I mean, that's the greatest reason that we have families, is that we desire to live in communion and fellowship and intimacy with one another. And there's something very precious about your own son or daughter. They are a reflection of you. They have your DNA flowing through their veins. In fact, in many cases, we end up looking very much like one or both of our parents. We end up also taking on some of their personality quirks and traits, and hopefully we pick up their good ones and not their bad ones. But we live in family or in fellowship with one another. And so if you, as a mother or a father, let's say that you have your own business, how many people have begun to employ their sons or daughters in the family business, and it's a legacy that they desire to pass on from one generation to the next generation to the next generation? Well, God mirrored that in creation. That was his desire when he placed man and woman in the earth. It was so that we would plant the atmosphere. Well, actually, God already planted the atmosphere of heaven and the earth when he created the Garden of Eden. But his desire then was that his sons and daughters would then cause that kingdom, that atmosphere, to grow and to multiply, and that it would cover the entire earth, and that man and woman would literally keep extending the kingdom of God into every sphere of the earth. And so that was his desire. So not only did he make us in his image and create us in his likeness, but he also called us to be kings and priests. So we're going to go to Revelation chapter 5. And I'm going to, in a few moments, I'm going to explain to you how all of this can have an impact of your understanding of how fear should not be something that you allow to take up residence in your mind, your will, your emotions. In Revelations chapter 5 and verse 10, it says, "And he has made us kings and priests unto our God, and we shall reign in the earth." I'm going to say that again. God has made us kings and priests in the earth unto him, not unto ourselves, but unto him, and that we shall reign in the earth. So that is the end of the book. And at the beginning of the book, it said that he made us in his image and he placed us in the earth that we might have dominion over all of the works of creation, over everything that he created. And why is that? Because God loves us so much. He desires his family to just keep extending and extending and getting bigger and getting bigger. And that we then would be co-laborers with Christ. We would be co-laborers with God. And we would just keep multiplying and reproducing the kingdom of God in every single realm of society. And so why did he want that? Because God loves us so much that he desired for us to live in an atmosphere that was free of sin, that was free of fear and doubt and worry and concern. He literally placed us in this amazing garden where he had face-to-face communion and fellowship with Adam and Eve. So at the beginning of the book and at the end of the book, God gives us his plan for creation. And in my opinion, I believe he gives us the reason why. Because he wants a family. And he wants us as his kids, as his sons and daughters, to keep passing on and building the family business. So what is the family business? The family business is, as kings and priests, we continue to build the kingdom of God in the earth. So what is the kingdom of God in the earth? The kingdom of God in the earth is building if you go back to, you know, times when kings and queens reigned, well, they still do in the UK, it was their rulership that was the governing factor of that society. And that's what God desires, because God is a good, good father. He is the only ruler of the entire universe who is good and full of mercy and full of grace and full of righteousness and full of justice. And so he desires that, because he is such an amazing, great Papa, Father God, he is also the ultimate ruler and creator of all the universe. He desires his sons and daughters, who he made us to look like him. He gave us different aspects of his character and his nature. He desired that we would be priests in the earth. And so priests in the earth simply means that we would set up worship unto the King of Kings and unto the Lord of Lords, that we would not bow our knees or our hearts to other idols or other gods, but that we would gather worship unto the one and only King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And it says in Revelation 5:10 that he also made us kings unto our God, which means, again, that we are supposed to rule in the earth and extend his kingdom. And so what we're going to do is we're going to go to Psalm 82. And I want you to hang in there with me, because I am going to bring this full circle and explain how this affects your understanding of the spirit of fear, and how fear should not be something that you allow to either come into your life and set up habitation, or that you allow to remain in your life, because God has called you to be both a king and priest in the earth unto our God. So before I crack open Psalm 82, I want to preface it with this. The enemy is like a roaring lion, roaming throughout the earth, seeking whom he may devour. Because Lucifer desired to be like God, literally he wanted to be God. For whatever reason, something happened and he decided that being one of the most beautiful angels in all of heaven, that wasn't good enough for him. he decided that pride rose up in his heart, and he decided that he wanted to be like God. Literally, he wanted to depose God and kick him off of his throne. Well, that's not possible, because our Father God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, he is the maker of heaven and earth. So Lucifer just wasn't able to do that. But anyway, since Lucifer fell from heaven and he became Satan, he was given, at least temporarily, the enemy, Satan, is the prince of the power of this air. In other words, here on the earth, he has some spiritual dominion, so to speak, but he only has as much spiritual dominion as we allow him to have, because God has given us the same authority as his son, Jesus Christ. And we'll get to that in a moment. But what I want you to understand before we crack open this topic of our supernatural identity, which, by the way, I'm only going to be able to give you just a snapshot version of it. I want you to understand that the enemy has an almost equal replication or fabrication or alternative that sounds good at the beginning, but it ends in ruin and destruction. So in the Mindset Mastery world, this is an area that has been definitely influenced by cultish beliefs. Well, what the world will say, and for people that do not recognize God as being the one and only true God, the only the Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, what the humanistic world would say, or even cults would say, or even, you know, just even some Christians do not realize that they are being seduced by the lies of the enemy. And it would say this: that you are the master of your, you are the master of your ship, that you are the creator of your life, that, that because you are a king or a queen in the earth, that you should be able to have everything you want to have and be everything that you want to be and achieve everything that you want to achieve, yada, yada, yada. Now, I'm not saying that there isn't some truth in that, but that version or that, yes, that version of your supernatural identity is void of one very important thing. That is a very self-centered, selfish identity that is apart from God. It basically says that I can do whatever I want to do. I can have whatever I want to have. I can be whatever I want to be, yada, yada, right? I'm not saying that there isn't some truth in that, because God did give us dominion in the earth, but that viewpoint is separate from God. It is separate from the fact that he is our loving Father who loves us dearly. It is separate from the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross, which purchased the forgiveness of all of our sins so that we could have direct access to God the Father. That version of supernatural identity is devoid of the leading and guiding of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit leads us and guides us into all truth. The Bible says in Psalm 23 that he leads us in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. So I do, again, before I open up Psalm 82, I want you to be very careful that you listen to any teaching that talks about your supernatural identity, but does not put an emphasis and an exclamation point on the fact that you are a son or daughter of God, but you are not a god or a kingdom unto yourself. Okay, that's just one of my soapboxes. So here we go, Psalm 82. It says that God, Psalm 82, verse 1, it says that God stands in the congregation of the mighty and he judges among the gods. This is talking about in heaven, where God stands in the congregation of all of those that have gone before us, and he judges among the gods. I think it's interesting that he doesn't say that he judges among his sons and daughters, but he judges among the gods. That word God, if you look it up in the Strong's Concordance, it means Elohim. And so Elohim, where it says that God, big G, the one and only true God, he stands in heaven and he judges among the gods, little g. So just like we are sons and daughters of the Most High God, then, and I'm going to go down to the next verse. I want you to hang on to your strap on your seatbelt, because I did not write this. The Holy Spirit wrote this into the language of our Bible. Psalm 82 verse 6 says, I have said that you are gods, small g, that all of you are children of the Most High. That same word God there is the same word Elohim, but it is small g. And so what that means is that if we are made in the image and likeness of God, if we are children of God, then that means that there is supernatural power, and the same spirit that rose Christ from the dead lives and dwells in us. Does that mean that we are God? No. Does that mean that we are supposed to be worshiped and honored and revered? No. Does that mean that we should demand our way in every situation of life because we deserve to have what we want, when we want it, how we want it? No. If we are kings and priests unto our one and only God, then that means that we are serving the Lord Jesus Christ's, his desires, the heart of the Father in the earth. And because we're walking in fellowship with God as our loving Father day by day by day, as we are aware of how much he loves us and how much we are cherished and honored by him, and that we take on the identity of being a co-laborer with Christ, that we are laboring together with God and with Christ to extend his kingdom in the earth, then we can understand our supernatural identity, as in Psalm 82, where he says that I have said that ye are gods in the earth because you are children of the Most High. Now, again, do not misquote me. I am not saying that we are like the Most High. I'm saying that we are representatives of God in the earth. But because we live in this human flesh, that is one of our downfalls. Because we live, since we are a triune being, we are body, soul, and spirit. Your soul is made up of your mind, will, and your emotions. Learning how to renew your mind, really, learning how to be a master of your thoughts and your internal beliefs and your emotions, is nothing more than allowing the Spirit of God to reign over your mind, will, and emotions. But it is your soul, your mind, will, and emotions that the enemy seeks to devour all the time. So if he can fill you with fear, if he can make you timid, if he can make you shy away, then you will not walk in your supernatural identity as a son or a daughter of God who is greatly beloved and who is supposed to be extending the family business in the earth, not building kingdoms unto ourselves. Okay, so I'm not going to go into a whole lot more of Psalm 82, but what the Lord says in the scripture, he says that he, you know, that big G, big God, the one and only, he stands in the congregation of the Almighty and he judges among the gods, little g. And he says to them, how long will you judge unjustly? And how long will you accept the persons of the wicked? He says, you are supposed to be defending the poor and the fatherless and doing justice to those who are afflicted and needy. He tells them, deliver the poor and needy and rid them out of the hand of the wicked. And so what he is saying is that some of his sons and daughters, they're not doing, they're not walking hand in hand with Daddy God. They're not extending God's kingdom. In other words, they're allowing the poor and the needy to remain afflicted when God says that he is the defender, that he defends the poor, that he defends the widows, that he defends the fatherless. So we are supposed to be his hands and his feet and his mouthpiece in the earth. And so what happens is that we get so caught up in us, what we want, when we want it, how we want it. And yes, God has called us to do great and mighty exploits here in the earth. But what the secular humanistic part of our culture will say is that, yes, you do have a supernatural identity. Yes, you are a king or a queen. And so therefore, you should go after whatever you want all the time. You should call those things that be not as though they are, and you should manifest, you know, as much wealth as you want, and you should manifest. Basically, it is a very self-centered identity, and it is a counterfeit to the gospel, which says that we are kings and priests unto our God. we are not kings and priests and many gods unto ourselves. So I want to make that distinction very, very clear. Okay. So how does this fit into the whole idea of us annihilating and overcoming and having dominion over the spirit of fear? So what happens is from the moment that you are born, because you were born into human flesh, so you have on this temporary flesh coat that you walk around in for somewhere from 75 to 100 years. So because you are human flesh, but you have a soul, which is your mind, will, and emotions, and then you have that spirit part of you that is eternal, that will forever live either in the presence of God or in the presence of the enemy. The enemy roars around throughout the earth, seeking whom he may devour. So what he tries to do from the moment that you are born, actually, sometimes he tries to do it when you're actually in your mother's womb, because as you are in your mother's womb, you are feeling her emotions, her thoughts. And so there is a transference of that in the womb. But the moment that you are born and you take your first breath, the enemy then begins to try to besiege you every moment of every day. He wants to convince you that you are not as loved and adored and treasured by God as you truly are. He wants you to see yourself as a slave to your circumstance, or as a victim to trials and tribulations. He definitely wants to paint a picture of doom and gloom that will cause you to live in fear, anxiety, phobias, and anxious disorders, what have you. He wants you to live in fear of either people or circumstances or anything else that might cause you to shrink back in fear. But again, 2 Timothy 1:7 says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but he has given us a spirit of power. So that spirit of power is literally the power to perform miracle signs and wonders. We, in all honesty, if we are walking in intimate communication and fellowship with our Father who loves us, we should be walking in our supernatural identity, knowing that we are extending our hands and our feet into the earth, and that we are simply representing him to the earth. And so that we are representing him, and that we are living out our kingdom purpose and calling through that relationship with him. And that as we do that, we operate in miracle signs and wonders. As we do that, we know that our identity is as not only a beloved son or daughter, but someone who is clothed with his power. It says that he has not given us a spirit of fear, but he has given us a spirit of power and of love. That word love there is the word agape. Now, this is, again, where I feel that our humanistic culture has taken this supernatural identity thing. There are many, many famous celebrities in Hollywood that now will tell you that through, you know, different types of meditation and such, that they have connected with the universe and they have tapped into their supernatural identity. And that's true. But they've done it apart from God, because they will not say that Jesus Christ is the Son of the one and only living God. They do not refer to God the Father as the maker of heaven and earth. They do not give reverence to the Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit of God. And so what they'll tell you is that, yes, that they have a supernatural identity, but it is very much unto themselves. God has not given us a spirit of fear. He's given us a spirit of power and of love. That word love is the word agape. That word love, agape, has such a broad, definition, but it basically is the heart of the Father. The heart of the Father is that all men, all women might know him as the Father, that they might know God as the one who will never leave them, never forsake them. He wants them to know that they are beloved and cherished. He wants them to know that they are valued. And yes, he wants them to know that they are strong and courageous, that they are the head and not the tail, that they are above and not beneath, that they are conquerors. He wants them to know all of that, but he wants them to walk in that identity through the lens of his love. And through the lens of his love means that we are not here on earth just trying to see how much we can get and how much we can do and how much we can achieve. But we are here on earth, walking in this supernatural knowledge that we are sons and daughters of God. And because we are so favored and so cherished and so honored, because we are clothed in his strength, and we walk out all of the fruit of the Spirit, that we are full of his love and joy and peace, and we are kind and patient, and we forbear with others, that throughout all of that, that he then showers us with favor upon favor, blessing upon blessing, and he just continues to bless us more and bless us more and bless us more as we build his kingdom, as we extend his kingdom throughout the earth, as we are co-laborers with Christ, and as we are sons and daughters of the Most High God. So I'm going to kind of bring this to a close. I'm going to wrap up our 6-week episode on annihilating the spirit of fear. So here's what I want you to know. God has created you in his image and made you in his likeness. You are not God, but you are like him because you are his child. The more that you come into intimate fellowship with the heart of the Father, the heart of the Father is one that extends love and grace and mercy to all flesh throughout the entire earth. The heart of the Father desires that all men might know him, and that might know him experientially, that they might have encounter after encounter after encounter with his amazing love, grace, and mercy. And so as you walk in that identity of understanding that you are not just human, but basically that you are a supernatural being that is temporarily clothed in human flesh, but as you walk out that identity, that you know that the same spirit that rose Christ from the dead lives and dwells in you. Therefore, there is nothing on this earth, no person or no circumstance, that should cause fear or terror to set up camp within your mind, will, and emotions. Because the Bible says that you are more than a conqueror. So what I want to encourage you with is, number one, I want you to go back and listen to every single episode in this series. We have 6 of them, and today is the 6th one. I want you to listen to each one of them 3 times. The more that you hear a message and you listen to it again and again and again, the Word of God is living and active, and it is sharper than any two-edged sword. And because I teach and I preach from the Word of God, as I release that and as your spirit hears that, you're going to get the second time you listen to it, the third time you listen to it, you're going to understand it a little bit more than the first time. And what's going to happen is you're going to see how throughout your life, where there have been certain fears and certain anxieties that you've struggled with over and over and over again, you're going to see how when I believe it was in episode 3 or 4, we talked about how trauma can bring, can set up a stronghold of fear or anxiety in your life. You can then look at those situations and go, you know what? In those moments, I didn't realize who I was. I didn't realize that I have a supernatural identity, that the DNA of God's, his love, his grace, and his power is flowing through my veins every day. And in that moment, I did not have to come into agreement with fear. I did not have to come into agreement with terror. I did not have to come into agreement with anxiety. But I can learn how to live free from those things, because whom the Spirit of God has set free is free indeed. So what I want you to take away from this is that you are a beautiful, magnificent creation of God's design. And he loves you dearly. He does not want you to be riddled with fear, doubt, worry, or anxiety. He wants to fill you to overflowing with everything that you have need of. He wants to provide you with unending amounts of his love, joy, and peace. He wants to provide everything that you financially have need of, and he wants to bless you on top of that, on top of that, on top of that. And then why does he want to keep pouring out that financial provision in your life? Because if you are walking in the identity of a son of God, then you're going to be using some of that money to extend his kingdom again. You're going to continue to extend God's reach throughout the entire earth. So not only does he want to be your provider, he wants to be your portion. He wants to be your peace. He wants to be your protection. So I share all of that to say that the only way that we are able to have mastery in these things is as we gain God's perspective in our life, and we begin to rewire all of these mind, will, and emotion issues where the enemy has come in and has set up camp and has caused us to walk in the spirit of fear. So as I close out today, I want to close out today with one particular scripture, and it is Matthew 12, verse 35. It says, "A good man out of the good treasures of his heart brings forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasures of his heart brings forth evil things." Now, where it talks about his heart there, I want, in this scripture verse, I want you to let that be synonymous with your core beliefs. So a good man out of the good treasure of his core beliefs, his life will bring forth good things. His life will bring forth abundance and joy and peace and prosperity and health and divine healing. But an evil man, or let's say even a fearful man out of the fearful treasure core beliefs in his heart will bring forth fearful things. And that is not God's desire for you. So as we close out today, I'm just going to pray over you. I do work in small group masterminds as well as with clients one-on-one, and I help them individually to walk through this process of renewing their minds, rewiring their mindset, rewiring their core beliefs until they get to a point where they are walking in a supernatural identity as a son or daughter of God who is here in this earth to plant the atmosphere of heaven and release his glory throughout the earth. You can follow me at my website, which is dawnchurchill.org. You could also, yes, follow me here on loveradionetwork.com, where we are learning how to gain the master's edge. Let me pray over you as we close. In the name of Jesus, Father God, I pray that for every person that listens, that you will begin to continually remind them that they are made in your image and created in their likeness. Remind them, Father God, that there is no circumstance, person, or situation that should cause fear, doubt, terror, or unbelief to rise up within their hearts. Father God, that they are fearfully and wonderfully made by you, that they are greatly loved, and that you have planted them here in this earth, in this time, in this dispensation, to do great and mighty exploits in your name and to release your kingdom and release your presence to the four corners of the earth. Father God, I thank you for causing them to come into a holy alignment with their supernatural identity, not a selfish, not a me only, not a what I want, when I want it, how I want it, supernatural identity, but Father God, that you would bring them into the knowledge of your son, of sonship, of what it means to be a true son or daughter of God. So Lord, I thank you for that in Jesus' name. I ask that you continue to pour out your love, your joy, your peace, your protection, your provision, and all that you are, that you would be their portion, their all in all, in the name of Jesus. Okay, y'all, thank you so much for hanging in with me in this last episode of Overcoming and Annihilating the Spirit of Fear. Make sure that you share this episode with someone that you love and continue to follow us and support loveradionetwork.com. God bless. Yes.